Thank you very much. So I'll be talking about the power of imaging and how we can actually look at the future. And this is what has been doing the whole time here, especially with this video. But just give you from our perspective, which is ultrasound, and also lead to another use of ultrasound, which is for therapeutic ultrasound. I'm not sure about how many of you have heard of therapeutic ultrasound, but hopefully by the end of this talk, you'll be more familiar with it. So unfortunately, the lights are too strong, but I hope that you can see an outline here of a three-dimensional fetal imaging. You can see the nose, the mouth, the actual eyes of a fetus in embryo, in utero. And this is actually something fascinating. The obstetrics imaging is one of the most common applications and the number one application of ultrasound. But we want to see whether we can go further outside of the anatomical imaging, which is also very powerful. So the first thing I'm going to talk about is imaging the elastic properties of tissues. So it's almost like touching with your eyes, so things that you cannot really feel necessarily because they're not superficial, similar to when you're getting a cold and you're feeling for your tonsils that have been inflated due to the cold. And if they're deeper in your neck, or if they're actually tumors in different types of organs, then you won't be able to feel them, but can you actually image what you would feel if you were able to reach them? So that's basically the essence of imaging, elasticity imaging, that's based on ultrasound, but using different types of processing and going beyond just the traditional and ultrasound imaging. So it's very simple. So you use palpation typically. The doctors for 3,000 years, for forever actually, have been using palpation to find tumors, especially for in breast and prostate, which are the most accessible organs to the touch, and of course the neck, also the thyroid. So this is a schematic showing how you can combine imaging with this palpation principle. So you have the transducer here, which is the sensor that sends waves similar to the ones that are coming out. My voice reaches your ears. The same thing happens inside the tissue at higher frequencies because you want the resolution that you don't have at the frequencies that we can hear, which are actually acoustic frequencies. So you have to go to the megahertz range, send a specific wave in the tissue, look at all the reflections of the tissue, and then apply a very small compression similar to the palpation on the on your throat, and then try to localize a very small mass, which actually is very deep. So if you were to touch the surface, you won't be able to actually feel how stiff and where this actual tumor may be. And then we can generate images based on processing of these signals and try to see what is the mechanical property, so whether this mass is stiffer, softer, but at least has a different feel to it on the image. So you actually look at how the signal operates like a spring. So if you have a spring that's actually softer, it will deform much more than actually a spring that's much stiffer. And then we make an image of that. So this is the traditional ultrasound that you would get of a breast fibroadenoma, which is a benign tumor. So this is called a sonogram. And it shows you the anatomy. It shows you where it is and how big it is. And the elastogram will show you the strain or the amount of deformation. And wherever you actually see a black region will be very stiff. So you can actually see an image of a tumor that you cannot really feel or palpate, but you're able to actually map and look at how stiff it is. And what is allowing us, this new methodology, which actually is integrated now, this is actually a slide from 10 years ago, but now it's in every ultrasound scanner, so it just made it a couple of years ago to every ultrasound scanner out there and has an elasto option. So you're able to actually see both the mechanical properties and anatomical properties of the tumor, and then try to differentiate between benign up here and malignant based on the discrepancy of the size. And you can see how the tumor, if it's malignant, is actually appears much bigger than in the traditional anatomy, because it's actually feeding from the surrounding tissue and it's dragging the tissue, the perilesional tissue, as it's called, the surrounding tissue of the tumor with it during the deformation. So you can actually use that for diagnosis, and we hope that you can actually bypass biopsy, which is actually just inserting a needle into the tissue and getting a sample of the tumor cells, which is very, very costly and very painful to the patient sometimes. The next thing that we actually do in my group at Columbia is try to actually transfer this technology also in the heart. So the heart has a similar type of reaction to the tumors. When you have a heart attack, the muscle that has jeopardized the function trying to compensate for the lack of perfusion that you get from the coronaries, and it starts to stiffen very fast. In fact, the part of the muscle that's compromised starts to stiffen up to 20 times more than the surrounding muscle. So, however, the physicians don't have this kind of information right now in the clinic. The information that they have is through this ultrasound scanner, for example. This is one sonographer that's scanning a patient here, the heart of the patient. And you can see how, again, the anatomy is similar to the fetal imaging. You can see the heart beating here, all four chambers of the heart. The valve is actually flapping around, which you want. And they try to eyeball the region of the muscle that's actually not functioning properly, the region of the muscle that's stiffening. And of course, they're very trained clinicians, and it's done in a dark room, not like this one, so that you can actually be able to pick up small differences. But you agree that it's a very daunting task to ask for the physician to get this information from this anatomical image. So what can we do? So as engineers, we look at the simulation models. Of course, we're mapping the left ventricle, which is the most important chamber in the heart. And this is what happens when you go from a normal left ventricle. This is your muscle. Healthy muscle in red. When you have a few burgers in your life and the coronaries are starting to occlude, then this part of the region, which is the left circumflex coronary artery, starts getting ischemic or has an occlusion of the artery that prevents oxygenated blood from going to the muscle. And this is the region that I was saying earlier starts to actually stiffen very fast, and actually later, depending on how the progression of the disease is, it can actually start scarring, and it becomes like a permanent scar on the muscle. So if you actually image across this normal case and the ischemic case, you're able to actually get images like this one, which help the clinician better detect the region of abnormality and also earlier. So we actually heard earlier that the stents are not very successful. Part of the reason is that there's no diagnostic modality to actually guide the stent correctly at an earlier stage, or actually use drug treatment, so overcome stents altogether and just use drug treatment at an early stage. So this is actually what the heart looks like, all red here, showing uniform deformation. This is what you want in a healthy heart. Once you start occluding one of the arteries and you go to partial occlusion of 40%, there's a region here that's actually having opposite deformation from the normal case. And then you keep occluding the same coronary artery to a higher percentage, 80%, and you see it's actually having a higher, larger region that's actually compromised here. And finally, at the complete occlusion, so that would be actually equivalent to a heart attack, you have a whole region here, almost half of the ventricle undergoing opposite motion. So this is actually a big region here that is compromised. And of course, it's very difficult to have the same blood ejected from the heart and do the right thing for the heart. So you would agree that, of course, this is actually an extreme case. So you don't need a modality to detect it. However, if you get a smaller occlusion, this is the one you want to treat early, probably with a drug treatment, then we're able to detect it. And we ask physicians to actually detect this based just on the regular ultrasound. And in fact, they detected this region, a diagnosis as normal, which is actually expected. It's a very small region. It's very difficult to detect it just based on the anatomical images. So we hope to make a difference here, where you can actually do an early detection at partial occlusions and make sure that the correct region of the muscle is detected as being abnormal based on the mechanical properties. So this is actually in the future. And we actually compare it also with angiography. This is the very much more invasive technique that you have with catheterization. You place a catheter through the circulation into the heart. You take a CTs or computed tomography scans regularly, which is actually extra radiation to the patient. Then you inject a dye, and you try to identify where the actual occlusion happened. And this is a complete occlusion here. You see there's a disruption of the dye inside the coronary artery. And you're able to get that with this invasive technique, but we actually get this also with our techniques, which is a standard elastography or transthoracic echocardiography, where you actually place the probe on top of the sternum of the patient, and you get the information to the patient with a 100% occlusion, and you don't need to actually go to a more costly and more invasive procedure to the patient. We can do complete occlusions. There are also partial occlusions. As you can see here, we can actually detect regions that have smaller occlusions of 40%, as I mentioned to you in the previous slide, and also 80% as well. So this is what we hope to get, a less costly technique, less invasive, much more less invasive, actually completely non-invasive. Ultrasound is also non-ionizing, so you're not having any radiation on the patient, and you're able to get the information you need. The next thing about, again, looking at the mechanics of the system is linking, also staying in the heart, linking the electrical activation with the mechanics. So in every heartbeat of everybody here in this room, we need an electric signal to actually drive the heart to contract itself. Unless an electric signal conducts your heart, you won't be able to contract the muscle. And there's a natural pacemaker we all have on the top of our hearts on the right side, which makes sure that sends the potentials down the fibers inside the heart, which are called the Purkinje fibers. And if you follow the yellow network here, this is where the electrical signal is propagating. And at the end of these terminals is where the muscle starts contracting. So right now, in order to measure the electrical potential in the heart, you will need to place electrodes, sensors directly into the heart. And I'm sure nobody in this room will actually volunteer for that, thankfully. So it's very difficult to diagnostically get the electrical information from the heart. So how can we actually use the mechanical properties to get the electrical conduction? That's through what's called the electromechanical coupling, which is basically telling you that there is a coupling between the electrical side of the heart and the mechanical side. So this is what we did first in animals. So this is actually in mice. You can see the contraction wave that goes from the apex to the base when you have the natural pacemaker doing its thing. That's actually called the sinus rhythm. And we're imaging the left ventricle here. And then when you do something very unnatural, you actually start pacing from the right ventricle, which is at the bottom of the heart, then there's a reversal of this wave. I don't know if you can see it, but it should be a wave, a red wave propagating in the opposite direction. We can do this also in a biplane mode or a pseudo 3D, where we have placed an electrode in this particular case, and we're following the activation, pacing activation, throughout the entire the ventricle, left ventricle and right ventricle, as it propagates from the area of where we're pacing. And we also can do this completely non-invasively. This can be done on everybody here in this room, where we actually have the right atrium, where your natural pacemaker is, and we can follow over all four chambers. This is the ECG down here, and look at the propagation of the waves non-invasively into a heart that's beating naturally. So following the actually touching with your eyes idea will be also to be able to follow the pulse. So that our pulse, our vascular pulse or aortic pulse, and that you can feel actually on your wrist, so this is your pulse at every heartbeat, we can actually image that in deeper vessels. So why do you want to do that? Blood pressure is very important, but we can only get it from the peripheral cuff pressure or ankle pressure. And in fact, the one pressure that you're actually interested in is the one that the heart sees, which is actually your central circulation, so very close to the aorta. So this is what we're imaging here. This is the abdominal aorta, which is a little bit lower than your diaphragm. And you can see the pulse propagation is a red wave from the heart side to the kidney side, so it goes from the top to the bottom. And you're able to see that propagate on the screen for a normal case, which is very nice and uniform. For somebody who has hypertension, it goes actually faster. And in the case of the aneurysm, you want to see where the disturbance of this pulse wave will be so that you can see whether the aneurysm is actually rupturing. And this is what we did actually in one of the patients where the rupture case was actually right here. You can see the propagation of the wave could not actually go over the rupture location. So you can use this imaging, again, completely non-invasively to determine the blood pressure of the patient, where the aneurysm is, and this propensity for rupture, and also detect rupture itself. And the other interesting thing about this is that you can get also the mechanical properties of the aorta and how it changes in the case of the disease based on the propagation speed. So if a wave goes very fast, then you know the stiffness is higher than a wave propagating much slower. And we can also get the constituents of the aorta, such as the elastin and the collagen. These are the constituents that change with aging. Elastin is actually what we lose very fast with age. And all our vessels are getting stiffer over time. And collagen is actually accumulating. So we can actually map aortas now and get the amount of elastin and collagen on the aortas and also the amount of stiffening in the case of disease, which is basically in hypertensives here. The other thing you can do with ultrasound is actually move tissues. So a wave needs actually a medium to propagate in, and in fact, the wave that's leaving my mouth right now, it's setting the particles in here, in the air particles in motion so that it can reach the tympanic membrane in your ear. If we were in a vacuum, you wouldn't be able to hear me. So the same thing happens with ultrasound. Again, we use similar types of acoustic waves and they propagate the tissue. And even during the regular imaging, you're actually setting the tissues or the body, the cells into motion. So very small motion on the order of angstroms or some nanometers. But if you elevate the pressure a little bit, then you're able to get vibration in the tissues. And the vibration is similar to trying to vibrate something and see how stiff it is. We can do this remotely in tissues. So this is actually a tumor you see here. Imagine a breast. This is the skin surface of the breast itself. And we have the transducer here, two different ultrasound transducers, one that's actually moving remotely the tissue and vibrating it, and the other one that's actually following the underlying motion. And in this case, we don't touch even the skin surface, and we're able, through the same concept as an optical lens, it's a concave transducer, and it has a specific focus. So where everything happens, where the energy is constructively adding up, and you leave everything else intact. So you have basically just a region of a millimeter vibrating where everything else stands still. So what do you want to do this? You actually want to basically get localized information on the mechanical properties. So you're basically knocking on the tissue at different regions, and I hope you can see something vibrating here. And if you can't, this is what you estimate, which is a displacement. You should be able to see an alternating vibration of red and blue here of the region that's vibrating. And we can do this across the entire breast and identify tumors, which are similar to what I said in the previous method of elastography, where we have stiffer tumors, we have blue regions or lower displacements, and you're able to identify them based on the properties themselves. So now for therapeutics, this is the second part of the talk. So you can use ultrasound to actually treat tumors, and this has been around. It's an older concept of the actual traditional imaging. The reason why it hasn't caught up yet is because monitoring is not being done yet, performed as well as what people would like to see in the clinic. But it's a very powerful modality. It's completely non-invasive, extracorporeal, and you can actually use it to ablate or burn tissues. So the idea is basically to replace surgery. So if you don't need, if you have a very localized non-metastatic tumor, or even if you have benign tumor or a recurrent benign tumor, then you don't really want to go under the knife every time. Because of course there's a risk of the surgery, and of course we all talk about the cost of healthcare. Surgery is very, very expensive compared to a non-invasive modality. So it can be an outpatient procedure where you come in, they know the tumor, they know the size, we have identified it, we know exactly where it is. So the only thing we need to do is excise it or burn it. So in this case, we actually use exactly the same methodology. Notice that we have just a higher intensity. So similar to me screaming right now, instead of talking, your ears are going to ring. So this is a mechanical effect that the acoustics can have. If you increase in intensity and you deposit energy over a longer period of time, you can actually burn tissues and very fast. Within about 5 to 10 seconds, you can actually reach boiling. So in this case, our foci here become the burning lesions, and we can actually burn across the entire tumor. And we can vibrate and ablate at the same time, and you can see the damage that you can do. At 10 seconds, you haven't ablated yet. This is actually a piece of liver. At 20 seconds, this is a region. You probably can see a region that's actually more pink than purple, where the liver is actually the natural color. And we can identify the lesion with our imaging as the blue area are low or high stiffness, so you have higher stiffening with lesioning, and we can identify that part. We can also do this in transgenic tumor mice. So this is a mammary tumor where there's a gene mutation and it's expressing similar types of tumor generation as the humans. So you actually can get a pretty big tumor, and you actually can get the lesion, the burning of the lesion inside the tumor itself, and how it actually follows the pathology itself. So we have a monitoring device now that can actually detect the lesion, the burning inside the tumor, after localization of the same device. So you can cause thermal effects, but you can also cause mechanical effects. So why do we need mechanical effects of the ultrasound? One thing that's already in the clinic is actually for a few years now will be to dislodge stones, very, very painful stones of the kidneys. That's called lithotripsy. And that's used a lot, especially when you have to brittle the stone so that it can get it, be excreted through the urine. So in this particular case, what we do is actually a big problem for treating central nervous system diseases. And I'm showing you a few of them. These are actually neurodegenerative diseases, such as Alzheimer's disease, that's affecting 4 million people in the US. Parkinson's disease, fewer people, but it's both very devastating. And of course, ALS or Lou Gehrig disease and Huntington's disease. And notice that these actually diseases are pretty focal, especially Alzheimer's in the early Alzheimer's stage. You're affecting just the area of the hippocampus, which is the memory center right here. So these deeper regions of the brain that it's very hard to reach and very difficult to treat early. So what can we do with ultrasound? So the main reason why you can't treat them is the blood-brain barrier, which is the region, the defense mechanism of the brain itself. And it says all these different drugs that are available right now, but they cannot reach these regions that I showed you earlier. So it's a very big problem in drug delivery. And ultrasound is the only one that has an invasive, non-invasive, and localized technique where you can get the information similar to this optical lens idea. Or you can get it delivered just in the area where it's affected by the disease and get the drugs to actually concentrate on this area. And we've been able to do this in the hippocampus, again, which is the memory center of the brain, and leave everything else intact. And finally, also, we reach what you want to reach, in this case, the neurons. Which are degenerating very fast, and we can see here that it turned fluorescent when the drug has been delivered properly to the correct area of the cells that need it the most. So I hope I have convinced you that this is actually the future of ultrasound, which has been one of the oldest modalities out there, but it's able to actually get you the mechanical properties, detect cardiovascular disease and diagnose it, as well as tumors, and also open the blood-brain barrier for drugs to treat devastating diseases. Thank you very much.